Welcome to the Voice of Victory, a ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church. Join us for the next 30 minutes as we minister to you from the Word of God. 2 Corinthians 13, I didn't say 1 Corinthians 13. Our love chapter. We're in 2 Corinthians 13, a far different set of scriptures here, where God says, examine yourselves, whether ye be in the faith. Prove your own selves. Know ye not your own selves, how that Jesus Christ is in you, except ye be reprobates? I'm going to read that again. Examine yourselves. That's not suggestive. God's speaking to us plainly here. Check yourself out, God says. Examine yourselves whether ye be in the faith. Do you have it? Are you in it? Is it real to you? And then he says, prove your own selves. I mean, if you've got it and you're supposed to be living it, where's the evidence? Do you see any evidence? Know ye not your own selves? You know you. You know whether you're a new creature in Christ or not. You know if you have any desires. How that Jesus Christ is in you. Man, if he's in you, like my pastor used to say, how can someone as big as God move into you and nothing change? Except ye be reprobates. God help us. Along that line, examine yourselves. Notice he didn't say examine each other. It's up to you. It's up to you. I've got enough work. I've got enough on my plate to keep track of Gary Piet. In Psalm 26, in verse 1 and 2, David said, judge me, O Lord, for I have walked in mine integrity. I have trusted also in the Lord, therefore I shall not slide. Examine me, O Lord, and prove me. Try my reins and my heart. If we say that we have what we have, then not only ought there be some evidence of it in our lives, we ought to be able to examine ourselves and say, yep, I'm different. There's no doubt about it. And maybe other people would say, yep, they're different. But God ought to be able to say, yep, you're different. You're different from when I found you. Amen? And by way of introduction, let me say tonight, in recent weeks, the president and COO, chief operating officer of Chick-fil-A, Dan Cathy is his name, has come under attack for a statement that he made regarding same-sex marriage issue. And boy, I'll tell you, it's really turned some heads, and it's really upset the apple cart. The point of this message is not to speak to that issue. As far as Bible believers are concerned, it's an open and shut case. Or at least it ought to be, right? That lifestyle is wicked, it's vile, it's an abomination before God. Chapters and verse available upon request. I don't know Mr. Cathy. Actually, in a sense, I'm kind of glad I didn't have to go through life with that name. Piet was bad enough. But Mr. Cathy, I don't know. And I don't even know if I would agree with him on all of his doctrinal beliefs. I've never been to, nor have I ever eaten at one of his fast food restaurants. I don't even know if I'd like his food. I don't own stock in Chick-fil-A. I've never even seen one of his restaurants. But I'll tell you what I am in favor of. I'm in favor of free speech. This is America, and we have a constitutionally protected right to our personal opinions. Furthermore, we have a right to express them. That even includes the LGBT community as well. If they want to go down to a Chick-fil-A and kiss each other, they've got a right in America to do it. Silly as it is. I mean, think about it. We're going to show you. Okay. Daffy people. I wonder how many of them actually did it. Well, you get a handful of weirdos that went down there and kissed each other. We're going to show those Christians now. All right, help yourself. I'm getting pretty tired of liberals and reprobates trampling all over Christianity. It's time for us to rise up and take a stand. Dan Cathy has reportedly made this statement. It goes beyond this, but this is the crux of it right here. He said, "We are very much supportive of the family, the biblical definition of the family unit. We are a family-owned business, a family-led business, and we are married to our first wives. We give God thanks for that." Can you imagine saying such hate speech? What? I believe that. From that statement, I'll tell you what, I know where he stands on the family. And I'll go one step further. I believe he has a right to believe that. It's America. Isn't it? It used to be. Has he discriminated against anyone in that statement? Has he refused to serve anyone because of their beliefs? No. He just said, this is who I am. This is what I believe. I believe in my family, and we're a family-run business and all that. And he comes under attack for that? I say God bless him. I say God bless him for having enough backbone to stand up for what he believes and do it publicly. Would to God we could get the rest of Christianity to do that instead of hiding. Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof, or abridging the freedom of speech, or of the press, or the right of the people peaceably to assemble and to petition the government for a redress of grievances. That's the First Amendment. I like it. Matter of fact, all of the amendments to the Constitution are under attack today. But see, this isn't even a religious issue. Does this man have a right to have an opinion in the United States of America? And can he voice it without being attacked? Where's the tolerance? Where's the love? Where's the acceptance? I guess it only goes in one way, that Christians have to embrace all that's wicked and all that's ungodly. But all of the reprobates of the world can look down their nose on people that are trying to live right and do right. Proverbs 28:1 says, "The wicked flee when no man pursueth, but the righteous are bold as a lion." Or at least they used to be. And thank God that there's still some that are still bold as a lion. And we're talking about a businessman here. We're not talking about a preacher. One of my favorite TV programs is The Andy Griffith Show. And other than Opie and Thelma Lou, I don't know how many of the others are still alive. They've all passed off the scene. Andy Griffith just died a little while ago. Don Knotts died a couple of years ago there. They're all in their 80s. George, what was his last name? Goober. It escapes me. He just died a little. I mean, they're all dying. But it was a good and it was a wholesome program. It still is. I say, why do you say that? Because I remember an episode where Barney Fife procured an old motorcycle. Helmet, gloves, goggles and all. And he set up what he called Checkpoint Chickie. Checkpoint Chickie. You should have seen him. He looked ridiculous. He's got this helmet, these big goggles, and he's sitting on this motorcycle, and he's got this big bush in front of him, and he's on the side of the road, and he pulls out in front of the trucks, and he's stopping everyone. It's Checkpoint Chickie. Well, you know what? Folks, it's time. Checkpoint Chickie was a place to examine the driving habits of truckers that were perhaps exceeding the speed limit. And he would pull out there and he'd stop them. And he'd question them about what they were doing. Well, folks, I believe that it's time. This Chick-fil-A fiasco that's going on right now, I believe is Christianity's, it's last day Christianity, Checkpoint Chickie. It's about time we come into question. We examine ourselves. Someone says, check, examine yourself. What do you believe? What are you doing? Time for us to stand up and examine ourselves and our society and take a stand for what we believe. Oh, sure, the truckers will make up excuse, just like they did to Barney Fife. Well, we need the extra speed. We have to change. You're going to overlook this. You can't speak out. Everybody's got a reason. All of Christianity has a reason why they don't stand up for Jesus Christ. Oh, and it's all under the guise of being tolerant and loving and caring and all of that. What it boils down to is they don't have a backbone. That's what it is. And see, the only way that Christians can get away with not doing what they ought to do is try to turn it into something spiritual. God said that we're supposed to be bold. He said the righteous are as bold as a lion. But then we turn around and knowing full well that we're supposed to be bold, knowing full well we're supposed to stand up and say and do what we ought to do, and then we say, well, I don't want to offend them. You know, I'm trying to reach them for Christ, you know, and if I offend them, then they'll put a roadblock, and then they'll never get saved, and I wouldn't want to do it. You wouldn't want me to do that, would you? Oh, cut it out, you spineless jellyfish. But like Barney Fife said, he said, well, if I let you go 35 today, you'll go 40 tomorrow. If I let you go 40 tomorrow, you'll go 45 the next day. You know? And folks, that's what's happening to us today. We're keeping our mouths shut. We're letting them eradicate Christianity from our country. And everyone's just letting it go and letting it go. Well, you know, it's just this, it's just that. But I'll tell you, with each passing day, they're going to chip away at it a little bit more and a little bit more and a little bit more. And the next thing you know, they'll close the doors to the church. Pretty soon they'll be lugging the preacher off and locking them up. Christian, if we don't take a stand right now, Christianity as we know it, along with its biblical principles, is going to be swept off of our nation under the guise of tolerance and acceptance. Proverbs 14:34 still says, righteousness exalteth a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people. Christians are being blown out of the water left and right, each and every day, compromising. God said in Ezekiel 22 and verse 30, I sought for a man among them that should make up the hedge and stand in the gap before me for the land that I should not destroy it, but I found none. Checkpoint Chickie, folks. About time somebody gets in the face of Christianity and says, hang on right there. We're going to examine this thing that we're doing. I'm glad that a public figure, a successful businessman, cares more about God than he does about making a buck. And he's willing to stand up and be counted for it. How about you, friend? What's your excuse for complacency and silence? In Acts 4 and verse 13, the Bible says that when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were unlearned and ignorant men, I'm tired of Bible believers being pegged as idiots. Intolerant, bigoted idiots. Hey, they've got more on the ball than most. Most people have to be educated out of God. They believe that they evolved from a monkey. I think some of them did. Or at least they act like it. It takes a lot more faith to believe in evolution than it does to believe in the beginning God. But he says there, well, they saw the boldness of Peter and John. Where's the boldness today? And perceived that they were unlearned and ignorant men. They marveled. They marveled. Well, what school did you go to? What college did you graduate from? We're just a couple of fishermen. It says there, they took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus. That's what this world needs to see. They need some folks that, you're only going to get that boldness one place, in Jesus Christ. In Acts 4, verse 29, and now, Lord, behold their threatenings. Isn't that what's going on all around us? They're threatening this, they're threatening that. Behold their threatenings, and grant unto thy servants that with all boldness they may speak the word. That's what we need, folks. Yeah, we've been praying up a storm. I'll tell you something about that prayer business. It gives people boldness. In Acts 4, verse 31, it says, when they had prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together. They were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spake the word of God with boldness. That's what we need, some people with a little bit of boldness, some Dan Caffeys. Standing up for a guy, I wouldn't know him if I walked into him. I have nothing to gain by, I don't even know if I'd agree with him. But I agree with his stand, to stand up and be counted. That's what we need in this life. Lord, grant us some boldness. You don't have to be mean and ugly. We don't have to be mean and ugly. You know, they're threatenings of, oh, you're mean-spirited, you're bigoted, you're this, you're that, you're a gay basher. It's like, no, I never bashed a gay person one time in my life. Hey, what they do behind closed doors, I don't even want to know about it. But don't come out, don't get in my face and tell me I got to accept it. Hey, if you want to be a pervert and you want to go and you want to be vile and ungodly and a reprobate and an abomination before God, go and do it. You'll give an account one day. I'm not going to give an account for you. Bless God, I ought to have enough boldness, enough backbone to at least warn you what God said. Man, God help our nation to get back on track. I just read this. The trial of that army psychiatrist charged in the 2009 Fort Hood shooting has been put on hold. It's been put on hold while he appeals the court's consideration of his objection to be forcibly shaved. You see, he hasn't shaved. He's in the military, and he hasn't shaved. So they're holding up the court trial because he says it's violating his right, his religious rights or something. What? Are you kidding me? This is a murderer. Now, understandably, he is alleged. But this Major Hassan there is charged with 13 counts of premeditated murder and an additional 32 counts of attempted premeditated murder. And it gets put on trial? It's put on hold because he didn't shave? What kind of buffoonery is this? Christians are under attack whilst radical Muslims get special consideration? What's wrong with this country? Where's the outrage? Where are the Christians standing up saying, hey, we're tired of this business? 2 Chronicles 7:14, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. In Acts 13:46, then Paul and Barnabas waxed bold. Would to God these last days bring us to a place where we wax bold. It says it was necessary that the word of God should first have been spoken to you. But seeing ye have put it from you, ye judge yourselves unworthy of everlasting life. Lo, we turn to the Gentiles. Hey, folks, let me tell you this. I'm going to tell you this right now. If you don't want to hear this, you're watching by television, you don't like this, tell you what. Grab that little remote and shut me off. It's America. You can do that. But bless God, I've got a right to stand here and preach this book and I've got enough boldness to do it. I'm not trying to force anybody. You don't want to do what this book says? Don't. I won't blow you up. I won't shoot you. I won't do anything. Matter of fact, I'll do just like they did here. I'll go on down the road and tell it to somebody else. Long and short of it. And that's all biblical Christianity has ever done. Why are we under attack? Second Corinthians 7 and verse number 4 says, great is my boldness of speech toward you. That's what we need. We need a lot of people that will be bold in their speech. Philippians 1:14 says, and many of the brethren in the Lord waxing confident in my bonds, Paul talking to the Philippians there, he said, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. See, that's what keeps us. That's what keeps people from speaking the word of God with boldness. They're afraid. They're afraid of the consequences of, we talked about that this morning. That's what keeps most people from doing what they ought to do. They're afraid. Folks, people died for what we believe. Can we grab a hold of that? People die for this. People were willing to be burned at the stake. People were willing to be, I mean, what they went through, the tortures that they experienced because they would not recant Jesus Christ. Salvation by grace through faith, plus nothing, minus nothing. Ephesians 3:12 says, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence by the faith of him. Again, in Philippians 1:20, according to my earnest expectation and my hope, that in nothing I shall be ashamed, but that with all boldness, as always, so now also Christ shall be magnified in my body, whether it be life or by death. Bless God, if they kill us, we're going to be bold enough to stand up for Jesus. 1 Thessalonians 2 and verse 2, as ye know at Philippi, we were bold in our God to speak unto you the gospel of God with much contention. Even if people rail on you, even if people laugh at you, even if, regardless, have enough boldness to still preach the word of God. 1 Timothy 3:13, for they that have used the office of a deacon well purchased to themselves a good degree and great boldness and faith which is in Christ Jesus. You know, it's just something that if you get in and you get in beyond your little ankles, get in above your knees, get in a little bit. After a while you realize, hey, it's nice. Come on in, the water's fine. Folks, this time that we're living in right now, don't let the Chick-fil-A thing go away. Think of it like this. I don't know how many of you have ever seen it, but think of Barney Fife pulling up in front of you saying, stop right there. This is Checkpoint Chickie. See, because it's more than just chicken sandwiches, folks. See, that's what they'd have you believe, that it's just a debate about some homosexuals kissing at a fast food restaurant. No, it's much deeper than that. It has to do with men and women, boys and girls that have enough boldness, enough backbone in what they believe to be able to stand up, regardless of what anybody else thinks, and in a loving spirit say, you know what, I am a Christian, and I stand on biblical principles, and I believe this is right and this is wrong. And if you don't agree with that, have at it. But as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. We believe God. We believe this book. Where do you stand? Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Do you have a backbone? Will you speak the truth in love? Or are you so politically correct that you won't stand up? Stand up for Jesus. God help us, folks. This tonight, right now, here, watching by television, listening on the internet, however you're going to listen to this, this is, for the Christian, this is Checkpoint Chickie, folks. Deal with it. deal with it. What are you doing? What are you about? Are you willing to stand up or not? You willing to be counted? I'm a Christian, folks. I don't know that I'm the best one. Probably not. But I trusted Christ as my Savior, and I don't care who knows it. January 29, 1985, I realized that religion wasn't cutting it for me. I didn't have the peace of God that passeth all understanding. And I didn't care what the rest of my family thought. I didn't care what the people in the workplace thought. I didn't care what the next door neighbor thought. And I still don't care. Because I wasn't going to hell for anybody. But I knew that I always knew this book. This was the Word of God right here. When this book told me that I was a sinner and I was on my way to hell, you know what I said? I said, thank you. I wasn't against it. I was appreciative of the fact that there was something in black and white that someone could show me in black and white and say, hey, this is it. And I could look and I could read it myself and say, well, there it is. And I believed it. And I received Christ as my Savior. I have no regrets about it either. Like I said, I may not be the best Christian in the world, but I've got enough boldness to be able to stand up and say, I trusted Christ as my Savior. I don't care who knows it. I'm trusting in Him and Him alone. So you think you're going to heaven? I don't think anything. I know I'm going to heaven when I die. I know because I put my faith and trust in Him. And either He's going to follow through on what He said, or He's a liar. And if He's a liar, He can't save you. He can't save me. He's not going to save anybody. My faith and trust is in the finished work of Jesus Christ. He died on a cross for my sins. He paid my sin debt in full. And I don't care who knows it. I'll scream it from the rooftop. And I'll share it with anyone that wants to listen. And if you had any sense, you'd receive the truth as well. But if you don't, see, I'm not gonna buckle down. I am not going to bend over. I'm not gonna crumble because the rest of this world in the day in which we live, for some strange reason, this country founded on biblical principles is now under attack for the very same things that people came here in order to establish. I'm not apologizing for it. It may not be popular in the day in which we live, but it's still very much needed.
You've been watching the Voice of Victory telecast, an outreach ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church in Blackstone, Massachusetts. We are an independent, fundamental, King James Bible-believing church. Our goal is to reach people with the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, our Lord. You are invited to attend any of our Bible-centered services. Our service times are as follows. Sunday school for all ages at 9:30 a.m. Sunday worship services at 10:30 a.m. and again at 6 p.m.